And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 3, Blind. I am the RPG Chick, and this episode, well, it had to be done. We have to go do some Codex entries. And hopefully I can pronounce words better than that. So I've done a bunch of readings in my cabin, in the captain's cabin.
Commander.
Hello, Shepard.
So we'll hang out here. Well, I can actually step here. Stand here. Thought it'd be cool with the, you know, the engine noise or whatever, what have you, in the background. Now we are completely caught up with the primary entries, so we just have to read the secondary. Extinct races, Rachni. Well, they're not completely extinct, are they? I mean, we did save the Queen, and she promised to leave the galaxy or something. Though not... Sorry, guys. Let me just get in my rhythm here. Though now extinct, the Rachni once threatened every species in Citadel space. Over 2,000 years ago, explorers foolishly opened a mass relay to a previously unknown system, and encountered something never seen before or since, a species of spacefaring insects guided by a hive mind intelligence. Unfortunately, the Rachni were not peaceful, and the galaxy was plunged into a series of conflicts known as the Rachni Wars. Attempts to negotiate were futile, as it was impossible to make contact with the hive queens that guided the race from beneath the surface of their toxic homeworld. The emergence of the Krogan ended the Rachni Wars. Bred to survive the harshest environments, the Krogan were able to strike at the queens in their lairs and reclaim conquered council worlds. But when Krogan fleets pressed them back to their homeworld, the Rachni refused to surrender, and the Krogan eradicated them from the galaxy. We know they're not completely gone. I mean, we have a mission concerning them coming up as well. Non-council races. Collectors. Funny them being leaped in here with non-council races. Living beyond the Omega-4 mass relay in the Terminus systems, the mysterious collector species is glimpsed so rarely as to be taken for a myth by most in galactic society. In reality, collectors are human-sized insectoid bipeds and can resemble massive winged beetles. They are a terrifying force in the galaxy, responsible for the murder of hundreds of thousands. Collectors generate permanent stasis fields around themselves, creating nightmarish red-shifted energy fields. In battle, they hold position whenever possible, relying on their aggressive bionics and nearly limitless power. Several types of bipedal collectors have been identified, including minions, defenders, zealots, assassins, and artillery operators. Acting together, collectors have imprisoned entire cities in stasis. While no definitive forensic accounting exists to explain the fate of those imprisoned, leading speculation is that victims are harvested for scientific experimentation and neurobiological repurposing. Krogan, ancient history. The lack of an adequately preserved archives presents a significant obstacle to research into ancient Krogan history. Nevertheless, recent archaeological discoveries have shed new light on the topic, revealing a society once rich with cultural, architectural, and artistic accomplishments. Newly discovered ruins reveal that the Krogan had particularly advanced understandings of structural and geotechnical engineering, as compared to other cultures at similar stages of development. Old Krogan architecture demonstrates seismic loading techniques that would have both resisted earthquakes and diffused the small-scale vibrations from vehicles in their surrounding cities. Curiously, however, Tuchanka has little natural tectonic activity. Instead, researchers believe that the ancient Krogan were concerned with safe cohabitation with one of the planet's apex predators, Kalros, the mother of all Thresher Maws. Really? Kalros, huh? So we've got a boss, Thresher Maw, I guess we're bound to fight that thing at some point. Prior to the genophage, Krogan population growth was limited by predation, disease, and war. Even so, the birth rate exploded once the Krogan achieved industrialization, leading to wars over resources and living space. Other species on Tuchanka suffered greatly as the Krogan expanded. When the Krogan ran out of land, they settled into an arms race that ended in nuclear devastation. Tuchanka's relatively short golden age was at an end. But this ancient history may yet aid the modern Krogan. Some of the techniques and technology discovered in the ruins could be used to improve standard colonization equipment, signaling economic renewal for the Krogan at last. The Krogan Rebellions. After the Rachni War, the quick-breeding Krogan expanded at the expense of their neighbors. Warlords leveraged their veteran soldiers to seize living space, while the council races were still grateful. Over centuries, the Krogan conquered world after world. There was always just one more needed. When the council finally demanded withdrawal from the Asari colony of Lugia, Krogan overlord Krennak stormed off the citadel, daring the council to take their worlds back. But the council had taken precautions. The finest STG operators and Asari huntresses had been drafted into a covert observation force, the Office of Special Tactics and Reconnaissance. The Spectres opened the war with crippling strategic strikes. Krogan planets went dark as computer viruses flooded the extranet. Sabotage antimatter refineries disappeared in blue-white annihilation. Headquarters stations shattered into orbit-clogging debris, rammed by pre-placed suicide freighters. Still, this only delayed the inevitable. The war would have been lost if not for first contact with the Turians, who responded to Krogan threats with a prompt declaration of war. Being on the far side of Krogan space from the Council, the Turians advanced rapidly into the lightly defended Krogan rear areas. The Krogan responded by dropping space stations and asteroids on Turian colonies. Three worlds were rendered completely uninhabitable. This was precisely the wrong approach to take with the Turians. Each is first and foremost a public servant, willing to risk his life to protect his comrades. Rather than increasing public war weariness, Krogan tactics stiffened Turian resolve. The arrival of Turian task forces saved many worlds from the warlords' marauding fleets, but it took development of the genophage bioweapon to end the war. There were decades of unrest afterwards. Rogue warlords and holdout groups of insurgents refused to surrender or disappeared into the frontier systems to become pirates. Varen, get a drink. And yes, as in the previous games, I will not finish this episode. Gonna read for as long as I can, or as long as I till I'm sick of it anyway. So I might throw a few entries at the end of, you know, missions and such if there's time. Varen are omnivores with a preference for living prey. Originally native to the Krogan homeworld of Tuchanka, they are, like most life from Tuchanka, savage, clannish, and consummate survivors. They are pack hunters, and when vulnerable prey is readily available, and become scavengers when outnumbered or outclassed. Their supreme adaptability, vicious demeanor, and rapid breeding cycle have made them ubiquitous and dangerous pests on many worlds. Virtually everywhere the Krogan have been, Varen infestations have followed, wreaking havoc with the native ecology. The Krogan have had a love-hate relationship with Varen for millennia, alternately fighting them for territory and embracing them as treasured companions. To this day, Krogan raise them as beasts of war. A common subgenus of Varen has metallic silver scales, leading to the rather unusual nickname Fish Dogs. Forcha. So we don't have pictures up here. Although they resemble a mammal-reptile cross, the Vorcha have no terrestrial analog. They are humanoid in form, but Vorcha have clusters of non-differentiated neoblast cells, like those of Earth's planarian worms. Damaged Vorcha cells mature into specialized structures to alleviate injury or stress. Transformations include thicker skin following injury, lung adaptation for barely breathable atmospheres, and stronger cardioskeletal muscle under high gravity. Skull capacity and brain size do not change, and Vorcha rarely make more than one somatic overhaul. Vorcha assault each other frequently, causing their young to gain strength, intelligence, and resilience. As a result, Vorcha see inflicting and receiving pain as normal communication. Few Vorcha study professions, in part because their average life expectancy is only 20 years. Because Vorcha can eat and breathe nearly anything, they can live almost anywhere, but racism prevents them from integrating into most societies that dismiss them as vermin. They have few employment options beyond Krogan mercenary bands. Yep, difficult to deal with. The Yogg. The Yogg are a race of massive apex predators from the world of Parnak, whose rise to sentience in no way blunted their violent nature. A group of Yogg is unable to cooperate until a single leader has been determined through either social maneuvering or brute force, but no grudges are held once a Yogg establishes dominance. Former rivals serve their new superior's purpose with unflinching loyalty and relentless determination, a legacy of their origin as pack species. Their eight eyes are another sign of their hunter ancestry. All four pairs are geared towards tracking down and predicting the movements of prey. Sophisticated and keenly developed sensitivity to movement and light have made Yogg masters at reading body language, regardless of species. Much to their short-lived chagrin, the Council's first contact teams discovered it was nearly impossible to lie to the Yogg. The Yogg had technology equivalent to 20th century Earth standards when they were discovered by the Council in 2125. The Council's ambassadors approached the Yogg as friends and allies instead of subordinates, a baffling sign of contempt from newcomers on Parnak. The Yogg attacked when it became apparent that the alien diplomats stubbornly confused themselves sovereign people instead of new underlings. God forbid. Parnak remains off-limits by order of the Council, which fears that the Yogg's size, aggression, and obsession with control make them poorly suited for integration into the galactic community. That's funny. Non-Council racism. The Krogan are here. It's funny that the Volus and other races are not. Unless they're under another, I don't know. Anyway, they might be under another, maybe not humanity. I'm not sure. I can't say what else they'd fit under. So maybe they'll be added later. Citadel and Galactic Government. Citadel Council. The Council is an executive committee composed of representatives from the Asari Republics, the Turian Hierarchy, and the Salarian Union. Though they have no official power over the independent governments of other species, the Council's decisions carry great weight throughout the galaxy. No single Council race is strong enough to defy the other two, and all have a vested interest in compromise and cooperation. Each of the Council species has general characteristics associated with the various aspects of governing the galaxy. The Asari are typically seen as diplomats and mediators. The Salarians gather intelligence and information. The Turians provide the bulk of the military and peacekeeping forces. Any species granted an embassy on the Citadel is considered an associate member, bound by the accords of the Citadel Conventions. Associate members may bring issues to the attention of the Council, though they have no input on the decision. The Human Systems Alliance became an associate member of the Citadel in 2165. Citadel Space. Citadel Space is an unofficial term referring to any region of space controlled by a species that acknowledges the authority of the Citadel Council. At first glance, it appears this territory encompasses most of the galaxy. In reality, however, less than 1% of the stars have been explored. Even Mass Effect FTL Drive is slow relative to the volume of the galaxy. Empty space and systems without suitable drive discharge sites are barriers to exploration. Only the mass relays allow ships to jump hundreds of light years in an instant, the key to expanding across an otherwise impassable galaxy. Whenever a new relay is activated, the destination system is rapidly developed. From that hub, FTL drive is used to expand to nearby star clusters. The result is a number of densely developed clusters thinly spread across the vast expanse of space connected by the mass relay network. Oh, we're making progress here, huh? Humanity and the Systems Alliance. Alliance News Network. Founded during the early decades of human space expansion, the Alliance News Network was originally a low-profile news organization known mostly for a series of exposés on the First Contact War. With a focus on galaxy-wide reporting, the ANN opened bureaus on planets across known space, winning a few awards for excellence and earning a multi-species audience. The Alliance News Network has never been funded by the Systems Alliance, despite what its name might imply. This led to regular confusion among those not in the know, although the network's recent high-profile sale to a media conglomerate made the ownership structure clearer. The new management has opted for a more sensational approach. This is particularly obvious from changes to its roster of reporters, with a few of the network's luminaries retiring or joining other news organizations. The network's increasingly lurid programming has gained wide attention as well as sorely needed ratings, all the proof that the management needed to validate its course. Nonetheless, ANN insists that integrity and credibility are inviolable standards in the newsroom. Battlespace is among ANN's highest rated programs, known for a particularly titillating breed of reporting. Among the show's most noteworthy segments are Diana Aller's dispatches from the front lines. The network calls her reports gritty and realistic, but she has been criticized for her unabashed focus on the violence of war. Even critics of Aller's agree, however, that despite her often graphic visuals, the facts she reports are just that. Facts. Pausing for drinks. In case you wonder. First Contact War. Humanity's first contact with an alien race occurred in 2157. At that time, the Alliance allowed survey fleets to activate any dormant mass relays discovered, a practice considered dangerous and irresponsible by Council-aligned races. When a Turian patrol discovered a human fleet attempting to activate a relay, they attacked. One human vessel survived, retreating to the colony of Shanxi. The Turians followed, quickly defeating the local forces. Shanxi was occupied, the first and to date only human world to be conquered by an alien species. The Turians believed the handful of ships they defeated represented the bulk of human defenses, so they were unprepared when the Second Fleet under Admiral Castani Drescher launched a strong counteroffensive, evicting them from Shanxi. The Turians mobilized for full-scale war, drawing the attention of the rest of the galaxy. The Council quickly intervened, forcing a truce. Fortunately for humanity, the First Contact War was ended with a diplomatic solution. Mass Effect timeline. Cool. And it goes from the past. I like that. Okay. 2069. Armstrong Outpost at Shackleton Crater becomes the first human settlement on Luna. It is formally founded on July 24th, the 100th anniversary of the first lunar landing. That's cool, I like that. 2103. Lowell City in Eos Chasma becomes the first human settlement on Mars. 2137. Eldfell Ashland Energy Corporation demonstrates helium-3 fuel extraction from the atmosphere of Saturn. 2142. Construction of Gagarin Station. Jump Zero begins beyond the orbit of Pluto. 2148. Prospectors discover the Prothean ruins at Promothe Planum on Mars. 2149. Translation of Prothean data leads humans to the Charon Mass Relay. Systems Alliance founded to coordinate exploration and colonization of extrasolar worlds. 2151. A shipping accident at Singapore International Spaceport exposes downwind communities to containers of dust form element zero. Alliance begins construction of Arcturus Station. 2152. Roughly 30% of the children born in Singapore after Element Zero exposure suffer from cancerous growths. Systems Alliance begins settlement of Earth's first extrasolar colony world, the planet Demeter. 2154. Commander Shepard born. 2155. Systems Alliance occupies completed portions of Arcturus Station as a headquarters. 2156. Some children of Singapore exhibit minor telekinetic abilities. 2157. Turians encounter human explorers, first contact war. Occupation and liberation of the human colony of Shangxi. 2158. Humans learn potential of bionics. An international effort to track Element Zero exposures begins. Roughly 10% of exposed children show some level of biotic ability. 2160. Systems Alliance Parliament formed. 2165. Humans establish embassy on Citadel. 2170. Batarian slavers attack the Alliance colony of Mindwar. 2176. During the Skillian Blitz, pirates and slavers attacked Elysium, the human capital in the Skillian Verge. 2177. Thresher Maws devour the Alliance colony of Akuz. 2178. In retaliation for the Skillian Blitz, an Alliance fleet wipes out an army of slavers on the moon of Torfan. 2183. Geth, led by rogue Specter Saren Artarius, attacked the Citadel, ensuing in a battle that cost thousands of lives. A few weeks later, the SSV Normandy is ambushed and destroyed. Commander Shepard is presumed dead. Okay. So that is a few weeks later. I was wondering the events of the end of Mass Effect 1 and beginning of 2, how much time there was in between. Whether it was, a couple weeks, a couple months, a year or so. So now we see it's a few weeks later. 2185. An alien race known as the Collectors abducts thousands of human colonists in the Terminus systems. Commander Shepard leads a team beyond the Omega-4 relay to attack the Collectors where they live, stopping the abductions. 2186. Current date. Systems Alliance Special Operations. Interplanetary Combatives Training, ICT, is the Systems Alliance premier school for leadership and combat expertise. The Interplanetary Combatives Academy, sometimes called the N-School or the Villa, recruits officers from every branch of Earth's militaries to partake in grueling courses at Villa Militar in Rio de Janeiro. Initially, candidates trained for more than 20 hours per day, leading small combat teams through hostile terrain with little sleep or food. Trainees who do well are awarded an internal designation of N1, and are invited to return. Subsequent courses, N2 through N6, are often held off-planet and include instruction in zero-G combat, military freefall, parachuting, jetpack flight, combat diving, combat instruction, linguistics, and frontline trauma care for human and alien biology. The highest grade of training, N6, provides actual combat experience in conflict zones throughout the galaxy. If the trainee survives these scenarios in an admirable and effective fashion, he or she finally receives the coveted N7 designation. N7 is the only ICT designation that may be worn on field or dress uniforms. There is little shame in failing an N course. The training is so extreme that even qualifying for N1 elevates an officer to a position of respect. The universal prestige of merely attending the academy helps to restrain trainees from taking excessive risks in pursuit of higher honors. Although ICT qualification by itself does not guarantee higher rank, those officers who are able to complete the program are typically well suited to senior leadership positions. Okay, Omega Reclaimed, Omega's Secrets. We have a lot. So we've just been through this the last couple episodes, guys. Aria. Let me take a little drink here. A powerful biotic, Area Taloke has been the sole ruler of Omega for some time. Rumored to be at least 1,000 years old, she is as skilled at combat and the use of her biotic abilities as she is at manipulation and power games. Ruthless, highly intelligent, and dedicated to maintaining her rule over Omega, Area is a force to be reckoned with. Though recent events have seen Cerberus take over Omega and send Area into exile, there is no doubt that Area will do everything within her power to reclaim what is hers. Needs an update. She did it with the help of Commander Shepard and the poor Nyrene, who died, sacrificed herself. Cerberus' occupation of Omega. The elusive man's plan to capture Omega was elegantly wrought. Experimental specimens called adjutants escaped from a Cerberus facility beyond the Omega IV mass relay, took command of a Cerberus convoy, and arrived on Omega to wreak havoc. With more adjutants incoming, Cerberus reached out to Area Taloke, claiming it needed her help to stop its wayward test subjects. I'm not even sure. I don't know. Heard about that. They first asked for her help. Reluctantly offering her own forces in an alliance, Area joined Cerberus's General Oleg Petrovsky aboard his ship to oversee the battle. When the adjutants overran the Cerberus Omega fleet, Petrovsky and Area escaped through the Omega IV relay. Really? However, Petrovsky's subordinate Colonel Raymond Ash had remained behind on Omega to take control of the station's defenses while Cerberus reinforcements approached. Announcing that it was protecting the galaxy from the adjutant threat, Cerberus seized Omega, giving the elusive man full control of the Omega IV relay and the space beyond. Without Area to keep them in line, the various criminal and mercenary factions on the station erupted, fighting both Cerberus ground troops and each other. Meanwhile, Area was taken captive by General Petrovsky. Realizing that the adjutants had simply been a ruse to capture Omega, Area managed to escape back to Omega, slipping away into its underbelly to organize a resistance force. Eventually, Petrovsky ordered the Cerberus forces to evacuate the station, but this was yet another ruse, this time to lure Area out of hiding. With his troops out of harm's way, Petrovsky summoned a massive Cerberus fleet and presented Area with an ultimatum. Leave Omega or lose it. Petrovsky threatened to destroy the station rather than lose control, and with no alternative, Area left, vowing she would return to claim Omega and take her revenge. Really? So when you come back, what's to say he doesn't do the same thing? Destroy the station. Of course he didn't, but... Cerberus, adjutant. I hate these things. Hold on a second. Adjutant is the Cerberus code name for the experimental subjects created at a secret facility beyond the Omega IV relay. The creatures are based on Reaper technology, and the adjutants encountered on Omega have the ability to infect any life form to create a new adjutant. Adjutants are deadly pack hunters. They initially remain hidden, observing potential victims and distracting them with subtle whispers. Still, doesn't sound like a whisper to me. When they select a target, adjutants ambush them with charged projectiles that create a violently unstable mass effect field that causes severe disorientation and renders the target helpless. Enhanced muscle tissue gives adjutants the ability to leap surprising distances. Yes, allowing them to close in and infect their target quickly. The baseline form of the being does not match any known species. Xenobiologists suspect that Reapers may have originally created and implemented the virus several cycles before the Prothean extinction, and that it still carries genetic traces of its original host. If this is true, then, like the Collectors, adjutants are a glimpse into the distant past at a species whose very existence and struggles against the Reapers has long been forgotten. It's still very mysterious, the Collectors. The Protheans, rather. I'm wondering how similar the Collectors are to the original Protheans. Like, were they originally insectoid, or was that something that was injected into their race to, you know, control them? I don't know. General Oleg Petrovsky. Military strategist and classic scholar General Oleg Petrovsky is one of the elusive man's most respected operatives. As a corporal in the First Contact War, Petrovsky was forced to take command of his unit and proved his tactical brilliance by holding off repeated Turian attacks for weeks. The war ended before his position was overrun, but not before Petrovsky had witnessed firsthand the brutality of the Turian war machine. Despite being praised and promoted for his bravery, Petrovsky eventually found more common ground with Cerberus than the Alliance military. Since leading the campaign to seize Omega, Petrovsky has proven to be an capable, if firm, administrator who is focused on containing or eliminating unstable elements before they threaten Cerberus's occupation of the station. Cerberus Rampart Mech. Though its initial invasion of Omega was successful, Cerberus was soon faced with the problem of controlling the station's large and often lawless population. An initial solution was to establish detainment areas bordered with impassable force fields, believed to be sheets of plasma suspended in a magnetic field. As Cerberus tightened its control of the station, units that could pass freely through the force fields to police the populace became necessary, leading Cerberus engineers to recover Loki security mechs from the remaining Eclipse mercenary chapters. When upgraded with Cerberus's proprietary mini-fabrication technology, shielding recovered from Omega's Element Zero processing plants, and additional ablative armor, the result was the Rampart Mech, a flexible combat unit designed for control and intimidation of Omega's inhabitants. Rampart mechs can seek out targets or troublemakers anywhere on Omega, even lower industrial areas where radiation can be intense. It is fitted with infrasound and scent markers that are fight-or-flight triggers for several species and are intended to subdue or disperse a crowd. When necessary, Rampart mechs can channel all available power into generating a high-intensity field that defends against hacking or biotic attacks and weapons fire, protecting the Rampart until reinforcements arrive. For combat, most Rampart mechs are equipped with a standard-issue shotgun. If damaged beyond repair, the Rampart mech destroys the shotgun's aluminum alloy heat dispersal sinks, coating any nearby assailants in red-hot residue that burns through armor. In extreme situations, the Rampart mech overclocks into a hunter-killer mode, diverting power from its unique shields to single-mindedly destroy its target. In this mode, the Rampart mech moves faster, attacking with a flash-forged omni-blade that targets unprotected nerve clusters and immobilizes the luckless target. The Rampart also channels excess heat through the dispersal sinks, visibly burning off material to create an intimidating display as it advances. It's like half-psychological. Nyrene Kanros. Born to a family with a long and honored tradition of military service, Nyrene Kanros left the Turian military after the emergence of her biotic abilities. Off-suspicious of biotics, the Turians shipped Nyrene off to the Cabal units, where her abilities and experience were grossly underutilized. After several years as a mercenary, Kanros was drawn to Omega by its reputation as a haven for capable freelancers. Nyrene's early years in Omega were a pivotal time for her. Arya Taloke took an interest in Kanros, helping her hone her biotic talents while developing her military experience and skills to their full potential. Arya also allowed Nyrene the time she needed to reconcile with her new way of life and her unexpected and initially unwanted abilities. The two eventually parted ways due to irreconcilable differences, but Nyrene Kanros remained on Omega. Upon Arya's return to the station after the Cerberus invasion, Nyrene revealed herself as the leader of the Talons. Reformed under her leadership, the Talons are Omega's newfound symbol of resistance among the Cerberus occupiers. Turian Cabals. The Cabals are an elite biotic Turian unit whose dictum is, "The intangible is unstoppable." As Turian biotics are relatively rare, with biotic abilities manifesting in only a small percentage of Element Zero exposed Turians, Cabals tend to be small and only comprised of 10 to 15 individuals, led by a commanding officer called a cabalum. A Turian cabal is often deployed covertly as shock troops or saboteurs, or they're sent on long reconnaissance missions for the hierarchy. In addition to advanced biotic training, all cabal soldiers are highly skilled in small arms, explosives, infiltration tactics, and piloting. Centuries ago, during the Unification Wars, military black ops would recruit Turian biotics as infiltrators, planting them anonymously in the regular infantry as observers or using them as assassins. This historical practice had left a cultural bias against biotic soldiers among the Turian rank and file. As a result, the Turian hierarchy prefers to keep its cabals isolated from other branches of the military, citing safety and unit cohesion concerns. Even Turians whose biotic abilities are not combat proficient are segregated into cabals, often forcing them to cut short their promising careers in order to serve as a medic or maintenance officer. However, cabal soldiers are professionals, those who do not adapt or quickly weeded out, resulting in strongly unified teams of experienced, deadly, biotic warriors who see their isolation as a necessary sacrifice to protect the hierarchy. The war with the Reapers means that the Turian hierarchy no longer has the luxury of keeping such powerful assets in reserve. Many cabals have been recalled to Palavin, while the most experienced have been dispatched to the front lines for surgical strikes on Reaper strongholds or to provide support for regular infantry. Done there. Organizations. Cerberus Atlas. With the Atlas, Cerberus's research arm has combined the deadly armor and firepower of a Emer mech with the tactical superiority of a trained human pilot. An Element Zero core allows the Atlas to be airdropped onto a battlefield with minimal impact damage. Its thick armor includes a robust, transparent canopy made from a polycrystalline composite, proprietary to Cerberus. Alliance engineers hypothesized the material is some kind of synthetic sapphire compound with interlayers to resist cracking and thermal damage. Drink. Okay. Although the Atlas is somewhat unwieldy in the field, its anti-personnel machine guns and ability to shrug off damage from anything short of a heavy weapon makes it a fearsome opponent. Heavy loss of life is to be expected in any unprepared encounter with this unit. Yeah, they're pretty tough. Centurion. Centurions are Cerberus's frontline tacticians. They are meant to enact the elusive man's strategic goals, although it is clear that they have leeway to adapt as an encounter develops. The only useful intelligence that the Alliance has gathered on Centurions relates to their armament. Each Centurion carries an M96 Matok heavy rifle, modified to launch smoke grenades, leaving enemies vulnerable to crossfire. Engineer. Cerberus combat engineers are specialized support units that assist primary forces while staying out of the line of fire. They wear lighter armor than the typical Cerberus combatant, using a modified mesh that allows greater mobility. Undercover and out of sight, engineers focus on setting up and maintaining turrets, as well as repairing mechanical units or armored allies. When confronted, they return fire only for as long as it takes them to find cover again and let frontline combat personnel take over. Although engineers are not particularly dangerous on their own, the Alliance specifically warns troops to remain on alert for turrets, which can mow down an entire squad while the engineer escapes. Guardian. Guardians, the Cerberus equivalent of human tanks, are slow-moving soldiers who carry enormous polycrystalline composite shields. The weight of the shield requires an armored suit equipped with hydraulic assists and a dedicated power supply. Combining this exceptional protection with a suite of enviro-mapping systems, Guardians focus on flanking opponents to flush them from cover. A Guardian's slow but relentless approach is intended to demoralize enemies as well as draw their fire, but rip away their shield and Guardians become little more than cannon fodder. Yeah, I've noticed that. Nemesis. The Nemesis is a Cerberus sniper specialist. Customized implants allow the Nemesis to withstand the crippling kickback of the M98 Widow anti-material rifle, turning a redoubtable opponent into a force capable of inflicting instant death. A suite of high-tech scanning equipment makes the sniper adept at maintaining cover, meaning a Nemesis is usually spotted only after opening fire, assuming the target survives the first round. Because of self-destruct mechanisms that activate upon the sniper's death, the Alliance has never retrieved an example of Nemesis augmentation technology. This fact, combined with Cerberus Force's penchant for suicide when faced with capture, has made scientific study of their implants impossible. What a shame. Alright, so got more Cerberus and some stuff on the Merc groups here. Phantom. Phantoms are agile Cerberus agents with a wide array of offensive and defensive capabilities, including particular specialization in evasive maneuvers and firing from cover. Although intelligence on the implant still evades the Alliance, Phantoms are known to be able to create a personal barrier for greater protection. Monomolecular blades and biotic shielding allow Phantoms to engage in close quarters combat, and Phantoms can briefly cloak in order to recover from injuries. Because of this ability, the Alliance recommends personal confirmation of a Phantom's death. Well, that's nice for them. Trooper. Assault troopers are the backbone of Cerberus forces. Those candidates who make it through the grueling basic training are submitted to an intense psychological program that renders them fearless, disciplined, and unrelenting. Outfitted with custom-designed armor and rifles, these soldiers function with determined precision and practice teamwork. The first to rush into a fight, assault troopers often work in tandem with more powerful units. They make strategic use of this scenario, keeping their opponents occupied until it is too late to react to the combined Cerberus force bearing down on them. The Blue Suns. Founded by the notorious Batarian slaver Solom Dalsara, the Blue Suns began as a Skillian Verge protection racket, providing genuine protection from slavers and pirates. Eventually captured by the System's Alliance Navy, Dalsara beat almost 24 charges to be convicted on a single count of conspiracy. The slaver benefited from the tutelage of cellmate and brilliant con artist Bernard Legit's Ledger. Upon release 5 years later, Dalsara incorporated Blue Suns as a legal security agency. Today, the Blue Suns boast a galaxy-wide force of Batarians, Turians, humans, and Krogan. Each deployment is backed by a logistic corps, selling everything from heavy weapons to shaving cream. Despite claims that Blue Suns sells its captives as slaves, no Blue Suns employee has ever been convicted on such charges. Many Blue Suns members sport the company logo in tattoo form, removed during assignments and reapplied at mission end. You can remove and reapply tattoos over and over again? Interesting. Eclipse. Brainchild of Asari Commando Jonah Sedaris, Eclipse was incorporated as a proactive security company. Influenced by Asari and Salarian military doctrine, Eclipse specializes in sabotage, assassination, and personal and organizational security. Although Citadel governments regard the corporation with suspicion, it's embraced in the Skillian Verge and Terminus systems. Early on, Sedaris sought government contracts to establish market share against the better-established Blue Suns. Her agency scored a galactic PR coup by retaking several space stations captured by the Anher People's Liberation Army and neutralizing its leaders. A victory Eclipse's marketing department never ceases trumpeting. Based on Omega Station, Eclipse controls nearly 20% of the asteroid's real estate. Its services range from mech repair to open warfare, although assassination is reserved for meeting wider, longer-term company goals. For instance, preemptive strikes against pirates rather than murdering spouses for insurance money. Despite numerous reports, Eclipse denies sabotaging or kidnapping business rivals. The Blood Pack. Originally a small Terminus Systems Vorcha gang, the Blood Pack was transformed into a legion by the visionary Krogan Battlemaster Ganar Rang. Exiled for striking a female in anger, Rang obsessed over reclaiming his lost status. Leading the Vorcha Pack as a pirate crew, Rang cultivated recruits and infamy for a decade before incorporating his fighters as a security company across the Skillian Verge. His notoriety ensured his public offering for investors made him rich beyond most Krogan's dreams. Rang returned triumphantly to his clan, rallying elders, Krogan hordes, and their firepower and biotic support toward professional violence in the Terminus systems. Banned from Citadel space, the Blood Pack bribes its way through spaceports into armed conflicts across the galaxy. Priding themselves for accepting otherwise untouchable contracts, the Blood Pack rejects bodyguarding and security in favor of cases requiring minimal oversight and maximal violence. Gotta love that Blood Pack. Planets and locations. Aiea, I'm not even sure how that's pronounced. Humans detected Aiea as an Earth-type world via telemetry in 2165. After probe surveys indicated life, lush vegetation, ample fresh water, and breathable air, the Alliance upgraded the planet to a garden world colonization priority. Commanded by Captain Ronald Taylor, the crew of Alliance survey vessel Hugo Gernsback made planetfall on the jungle world in 2173. Soon after, ship transmissions inexplicably stopped. While the precise fate of the Hugo Gernsback command and crew is unknown, they are presumed killed in action and their vessel destroyed. Yes, Jacob's father and the whole Jacob, loyalty mission. We find out exactly what happened to them. Anyway, that's in Mass Effect 2, by the way. Pharos. Pharos is a habitable world in the Attican Beta Cluster. Two-thirds of the habitable surface is covered with the ruins of a crumbling Prothean megatropolis. In the millennia since the Prothean extinction, the ruins have been picked over by looters many times. Pharos was considered a poor prospect for colonization, as little open ground remains for agriculture. The only sizable fresh water sources are the poles, which are tapped by the decaying Prothean aqueduct systems. The dead cities, while in good condition, considering their antiquity, are of uncertain stability. Ground level is congested by a dozen meters of fallen debris, and the air is fouled by dust. In 2178, the Human Exogeny Corporation announced its intention to place a permanent colony on Pharos to thoroughly explore the ruins. The pioneer settlement was placed on the upper levels of several intact skyscrapers using the surviving Prothean aqueducts and rooftop hydroponic gardens to support the population. And yes, that was actually a mission in the first Mass Effect. Pretty interesting mission. Freedom's Progress from Mass Effect 2. Freedom's Progress colony was once a typical Alliance settlement, but following a complete communications blackout and its apparent destruction, is now a lightning rod for anxiety and dread in the galactic human community. The communications blackout followed an upgrade of the colony's small military force, supplemented by mechs and security drones with high-powered tower-mounted Guardian lasers. Colonists complained about construction costs, overruns, delays, noise, and damage to the local environment. They also feared the defense array could be seen as provocative to their world's neighbors. Such fears may not have been baseless. Authorities have still offered no explanation for the communications blackout, fueling rumors of plagues, natural disasters, or a cult-inspired mass suicide. Located in strategically insignificant space, Freedom's Progress Colony had once offered residents spectacular rainbows, lush marshlands, and stunning mountain ranges. Its potential as an agricultural settlement and tourism wonderland rivaled that of any Alliance colony. Oh my god, there's a lot of worlds. Haystrom. Before the Geth Revolt 300 years ago, the Quarians colonized Haystrom to study the mysterious instability of its sun, which threatened premature eruption into a red giant. As a scientific outpost of minimal military value, Haystrom was ill-equipped to repel Geth forces during the insurrection and fell quickly under their control. Yeah, another mission from Mass Effect 2. Yeah, it's a pretty interesting one, actually. Captured Geth planetary survey data indicates that despite sustaining damage, Haystrom's architecture remains as it was before the war, preserving a Quarian architectural style that no longer exists anywhere else in the galaxy. Because Haystrom's sun has overwhelmed the planet's protective magnetosphere, humans foolhardy enough to venture into Geth-controlled Haystrom must exercise extreme caution. Minutes of radiation exposure will overload shields, and hours of exposure will kill. Furthermore, solar output renders surface-to-orbit communication nearly impossible. Ilium. A regional hub of Asari commerce, awash in riches, Ilium is infamous for its abusive labor practices and legalization of nearly everything except murder. As such, Ilium is the preferred production site for weapons and pharmaceuticals that would be illegal nearly everywhere else, made even more lucrative by legal indentured servitude. Among the bionics-related pharmaceutical producers is the Dantius Corporation, a rising star in galactic commerce. Despite the dangers of its products, Ilium is renowned for glamour, luxury, and safety, provided by near-total surveillance, making it a favored tourist destination. Countless celebrities maintain palatial estates on Ilium and in its capital, Nos Astra. The sole obstacle to business on Ilium is its extensive bureaucracy, tolerated only for its provision of security. Regardless of the character of its economy, Ilium's self-congratulatory media exalts its own society with the provincial arrogance of new money, glorifying in sexiest CEOs and 10 richest residence lists. Ilos. Like the ancient human city of Troy, Ilos is a world known only through second-handed sources. References to Ilos have been found at several other Prothean ruins, though direct study of the world is unlikely to occur. Ilos lies in a remote area of the Terminus systems only accessible by the legendary Mu Relay. 4,000 years ago, the Mu Relay was knocked out of position by a supernova and lost. Since then, Ilos and its cluster have been inaccessible. Occasionally, a university will organize an expedition to chart a route to Ilos using conventional FTL drive. These never get beyond the planning stages due to the distance and danger. The journey could take years or decades, passing through the hostile Terminus systems and dozens of unexplored systems. Corlys. Known as the Starcraft Cemetery, Corlys was the regional toxic junkyard for centuries. Ships reaching astronomical near-death at connecting mass relays were sent to Corlys, stripped of every useful component, then dumped planetward to clear shipping lanes. Currently, Corlys hosts numerous Merc factions such as the Blue Suns, rumored to be using downed ship fossils to test advanced munitions. Massive gun batteries threaten anyone attempting planetfall, with minimal defenses against ground attack. Because ancient volcanism greenhoused the planet, Corlys was too hot and CO2-rich to develop a biosphere, despite the abundant lakes that could have sponsored the development of life. Now cool enough for protected habitation, but too scorching for anyone but extremophiles and mercenaries seeking secrecy, Corlys supports numerous Krogan outposts. The Krogan have therefore seeded Corlys with hardy Varan, often kept as warhounds. Varan live primarily on a diet of geophagous vermin and each other. Novaria, the ice planet from the beginning of Mass Effect 1. Novaria is a cool, rocky world with most of its hydrosphere locked up in massive glaciers. A privately chartered colony world, the planet is owned by the Novaria Development Corporation Holding Company. The NDC is funded by investment capital from 24 high technology development firms and administered by an executive board representing their interests. The investors built remote hot labs in isolated locations across Novaria's surface. These facilities are used for research too dangerous or controversial to be performed elsewhere, as Novaria is technically not part of Citadel space and therefore exempt from Council law. by special arrangement, Citadel special tactics and reconnaissance agents have been granted extraterritorial privileges, but it remains to be seen how committed the executive board is to that principle. Given its unique situation, it is understandable that Novaria is often implicated in all manner of wild conspiracy theories. Omega. Still a bunch. Originally an asteroid rich in element zero, Omega was briefly mined by the Protheans, who eventually abandoned it due to its thick, impenetrable crust. Thousands of years later, nature did what even the Protheans could not. A collision with another asteroid broke Omega in half, exposing its trove of element zero for easy mining. A rush ensued as corporations and private individuals tried to strike it rich on Omega, and thieves and outlaws followed in their wake. As space became tight, construction of processing facilities extended vertically from the asteroid, creating Omega's jellyfish-like silhouette. To prevent future collisions, the station is ringed with enormous mass effect fuel generators that redirect incoming debris. Today, Omega is a major hub of narcotics, weapons, and ESO trafficking without even a pretense of civilian government or military control. Only mercenary groups have been able to instill a limited order. The most ruthless is an Asari syndicate run by the notorious Arya Taloq. Pragya. Choked by the hypergrowth of non-native plant species, Pragya serves as a galactic reminder about the imperative for careful regulation during colonization. 2 centuries ago, Batarian agribusiness chose uninhabited Pragya as their empire's breadbasket. Colonization authorities introduced non-native, industrially mutated plants that flourished in the world's fertile volcanic soil. Synergizing with Pragya's natural geothermal conditions and chemotropic microbes, the imported species soon became a nightmare. I can barely read this, guys. Mutant strains of poisonous and even carnivorous plants arose, overgrowing colonies in days instead of years, and causing the Batarians to abandon their holdings. Because the planet's small animal population is insufficient to check its plant growth, Alliance ecologists predict soil exhaustion in 400 years. Due to its relative isolation and lack of population, Pragya has become a regional haven for drug runners, weapons smugglers, pirates, mercenaries, terrorists, and intelligence agencies seeking secrecy. Rakana. The Drell homeworld of Rakana once teemed with life, its arid plains home to spectacular insect and reptile analogs. But the Drell took to industrialization early and did not realize the extent of the environmental damage they caused until it was too late. With their topsoil depleted and oceans too acidic to sustain life, the Drell were situated for a massive population crash by 2025 CE. It was then that the Hanar stepped in, mounting a large-scale rescue operation to bring Drell to the Hanar homeworld Kaji. As wars erupted over what resources remain on Rakana and billions began to die, approximately 375,000 Drell escaped in the exodus. To repay their debt, the Drell entered into an agreement with the Hanar, called the Compact. It states that the Drell would assist the Hanar with tasks the Hanar cannot physically perform. Today, high-ranking Hanar are often inseparable from their Drell attendants. Sanctum. Sanctum is known for the freezing ice storms which sweep across its poles and temperate zones, with only a thin strip of habitable land across the equator. Because of those harsh living conditions, Sanctum attracts only the most gruff and hardy, from miners to mercenaries to company men. Mining, referred to as ice cracking anywhere but the equator, is the backbone of Sanctum's economy. The planet is rich in platinum and palladium deposits, as well as boron, which is locally used in semiconductor doping. Sanctum's corporate factions have learned that Cerberus is involved in the planet's finances. Systems Alliance intelligence agents embedded within the corporate strata are quietly urging the companies to confront Cerberus directly. But so far, financial bickering has kept Sanctum's major stakeholders from acting against the elusive man. Terminus Systems. The Terminus Systems are located on the far side of the Attican Traverse, beyond the space administered by the Citadel Council or claimed by the Human Systems Alliance. It is populated by a loose affiliation of minor species, united only in their refusal to acknowledge the political authority of the Council or adhere to the Citadel Conventions. Their independence comes at a price. The Terminus is fraught with conflict. War among the various species is common, as governments and dictators constantly rise and fall. The region is a haven for illegal activities, particularly piracy and the slave trade. At least once a year, a fleet from Terminus invades the nearby Attican Traverse. These attacks are typically small raids against poorly defended colonies. The Council rarely retaliates, as sending patrols into the Terminus systems could unify the disparate species against their common foe, triggering a long and costly war. The Migrant Fleet. The Flotilla, or the Migrant Fleet, is a fleet of roughly 50,000 starships that houses over 17 million Quarians. The largest collection of starfaring vessels in the galaxy, the fleet is so large it may take days for all the ships to pass through a mass relay. Wow. The ships are constantly repaired, replaced, and upgraded to comfortably house as many Quarians as possible. Typically, ships specialize in roles for the fleet, from the enormous agricultural live ships to the shielded lab ships, to the repurposed freighters known as home ships that host Quarian children, young parents, and educators. Employed Quarians typically live in the ship they work on, since commuting from ship to ship ties up resources with unnecessary docking procedures. Even within the flotilla, Quarians on most ships will remain encased in their protective suits. Rarely, Quarians will meet on clean ships for specific purposes, such as medical services or reproduction. When this occurs, they remove their suits, knowing full well that it is likely they will spend a few days having allergic reactions or getting over infections as their weakened immune systems compensate for each other's presence. That's something I didn't originally realize, is that they're, like, allergic and can get infections from each other as well. Originally, that was not stated. It was just, like, among alien races. Now among each other. I can't imagine being stuck in that suit, like, for practically all my life. That's crazy. The Perseus Vale. As vast in natural beauty as it is in threat, the purple and gold nebula called the Perseus Vale forms the natural border between Geth space and the Terminus systems. The Vale's total opacity prevents Council intelligence from surveying Geth activity. Theoretically, the Geth could be preparing a devastating attack against which the Council could be defenseless, or the Geth could have died out so that the defense budget against them could be gaining the Alliance nothing but economic ruination. Despite fears of Geth, prospectors do occasionally mount salvage ventures inside the Vale. One ended in tragedy. Using techno-mental domination, the Geth drew the team into the Vale before aiming them back as husks at the organic society that produced them. A leaked classified Spectre report claims that the Dreadnought Sovereign, commanded by ex-Spectre Saurian Artarius and crewed by Geth, hid near the Vale before initiating the 2183 Citadel attack. Finally, Vermeier. Vermeier is a lush world located on the frontier of the Attican Traverse. Its vast seas and orbital position on the inner life zone have created a wide equatorial band of humid tropical terrain. Only the political instability of the region has impeded efforts at colonization. Many times, the Citadel has opened negotiations to settle Vermeier with the various criminal gangs and petty dictatorships in the nearby Terminus systems. All fell apart due to internal power shifts within the opposing parties. The Citadel has written off the colonization of Vermeier as impossible without significant political change. The Terminus powers themselves are unlikely to ever settle Vermeier. Most lack the resources to support settlement of a virgin world, finding it more expedient to steal from the neighbors than build for themselves. Do I dare go into the next one? So we've read quite a bit of these what do you call it? These subcategories? Categories? Whatever. Planets and locations. What? We just looked at that, right? Yeah. Ships and vehicles. Not too many. FTL drive. Faster than light drives use element zero cores to reduce the mass of the ship, allowing higher rates of acceleration. This effectively raises the speed of light within the mass effect field, allowing high-speed travel with negligible relativistic time dilation effects. Starships still require conventional thrusters, chemical rockets, commercial fusion torch, economy ion engine, or military anti-proton drive, in addition to the FTL drive core. With only a core, a ship has no motive power. The amount of ESO and power required for a drive increases exponentially to the mass being moved and the degree it is being lightened. Very massive ships or very high speeds are prohibitively expensive. If the field collapses while the ship is moving at faster than light speed, the effects are catastrophic. The ship is snapped back to sublight velocity, the enormous excess energy shed in the form of lethal Cherenkov radiation. Military ship classifications. Larger warships are generally classified in one of four weights. Frigates are small, fast ships used for scouting and screening larger vessels. Frigates often operate in wolf-pack flotillas. Cruisers are middle-weight combatants, faster than dreadnoughts and more heavily armed than frigates. Cruisers are the standard patrol unit on often lead frigate flotillas. Dreadnoughts are kilometer-long capital ships mounting heavy, long-range firepower. They are only deployed for the most vital missions. Carriers are dreadnought-sized vessels that also carry large numbers of fighters. Smaller vessels are almost exclusively used in support role to the warships during combat. Fighters are one-man craft used to perform close-range attacks on enemy ships. Interceptors are one-man craft optimized for destroying opposing fighters. Okay. Normandy SR-1. Never heard of it. The SSV Normandy SR-1 was a prototype starship developed by the Human Systems Alliance with assistance from the Citadel Council. The ship employed state-of-the-art stealth technology for reconnaissance in dangerous regions. Most ships emit heat that is easy to detect against the absolute zero background of space. The Normandy, however, could temporarily store its waste heat deep within the hull, allowing the ship to travel undetected for hours or drift passively for days of covert operation. This was not without risk. Eventually the stored heat had to be released, or it would build to levels that could cook the crew alive. Another key component of the Normandy stealth system was the revolutionary Tantalus drive, a mass effect core twice the size of a standard unit. The Tantalus drive generated mass concentrations that the Normandy fell into, allowing it to move without the use of heat-emitting thrusters. The Normandy SR-1 was destroyed in 2183 when it was ambushed by a collector ship in the Omega Nebula. Space combat. Shells lofted by surface navies crash back to Earth when their acceleration is overwhelmed by gravity and air resistance. In space, a projectile has unlimited range. It will keep moving until it hits something. Practical gunnery range is determined by the velocity of the attacker's ordnance and the maneuverability of the target. Beyond a certain range, a small ship's ability to dodge trumps a larger attacker's projectile speed. The longest range combat occurs between dreadnoughts, whose projectiles have the highest velocity but are the least maneuverable. The shortest range combat is between frigates, which have the slowest projectile velocities and the highest maneuverability. Opposing dreadnoughts open with a main gunnery artillery duel at extreme ranges of tens of thousands of kilometers. The fleets close, maintaining evasive lateral motion while keeping their bow guns facing the enemy. Fighters are launched and attempt to close to disruptor torpedo range. Cautious admirals weaken the enemy with ranged fire and fighter strikes before committing to close action. Aggressive commanders advance so cruisers and frigates can engage. At long range, the main guns of cruisers become useful. Friendly interceptors engage enemy fighters until the attackers enter the range of ship-based guardian fire. dreadnoughts fire from the rear, screened by smaller ships. Commanders must decide whether to commit to a general melee or retreat into FTL. At medium range, ships can use broadside guns. Fleets intermingle and it becomes difficult to retreat in order. Ships with damaged kinetic barriers are vulnerable to wolfpack frigate flotillas that speed through the battle space. Only fighters and frigates enter close knife fight ranges of 10 or fewer kilometers. Fighters loose their disruptor torpedoes, bringing down a ship's kinetic barriers and allowing it to be swarmed by frigates. Guardian lasers become viable weapons, swatting down fighters and boiling away warship armor. Neither dreadnoughts nor cruisers can use their main guns at close range. Laying the bow on a moving target becomes impossible. Superheated thruster exhaust becomes a hazard. Oh, we've read a lot. An hour and 12 in. Technology. I think it looks like there's less entries, you know, at the beginning of the game than the first two. There's bound to be add a bunch on, probably more on than in the first two games as the game progressed. Like, most of the Codex was, like, already there in Mass Effect 1 and 2. Now it's like, I see things missing, you know, and I know they're going to be added at some point. They have to be. The Citadel Council has called for the immediate donation of Prothean artifacts to bolster the war effort, primarily items of Reaper origin and recordings of their attacks. The Exogeny Corporation set an example by donating a store of newly discovered paleo technology and releasing the data archives of deep space research colonies destroyed by the Reapers. Several private collectors have since stepped forward to donate the entirety of their collections. But despite an offer of amnesty for anyone concealing such artifacts, not everyone has responded as the Council hoped. Several artifacts have been found in obscure underground markets on safe haven worlds, presumably sold by newly arrived refugees who needed funds to survive. Reports say that smugglers continue to sell stolen artifacts, and armed raids on archaeological sites have rendered even legal operations extremely hazardous. After several reports of mercenary groups turning on the archaeologists who hired them, Atlantis Risk Control Services began to offer security details for archaeological sites at considerably reduced rates. Artificial intelligence, or AI. An artificial intelligence is a self-aware computing system capable of learning and independent decision-making. Creation of a conscious AI requires adaptive code, a slow, expensive education, and a specialized quantum computer called a blue box. An AI cannot be transmitted across a communication channel or computer network. Without its blue box, an AI is no more than data files. Loading these files into a new blue box will create a new personality, as variations in the quantum hardware and runtime results create unpredictable variations. That's pretty interesting. I don't remember this blue box from the previous game's entries, or the game itself. The Geth serve as a cautionary tale against the dangers of rogue AI, and in Citadel space they are technically illegal. Advocacy groups argue, however, that an AI is a living, conscious entity deserving the same rights as organics. They argue that continued use of the term artificial is institutionalized racism on the part of organic life. The term synthetic is considered the politically correct alternative. Virtual intelligence, or VI. A virtual intelligence is an advanced form of user interface software. VIs use a variety of methods to simulate natural conversation, including an audio interface and an avatar personality to interact with. Although a VI can provide a convincing emulation of sentience, they are not self-aware, nor can they learn or take independent action. VIs are used on operating systems on commercial and home computers. Minimal VI agents are also available. Agents are compact and specialized. Some serve as personal secretaries, filtering calls and scheduling meetings based on user-defined priorities. Others are advanced search engines propagating themselves across the extranet to collate user-requested data. Commercial VIs in a variety of stock personalities are available at any software retailer. Boutique firms and hobbyists also build unique VIs to personal specification. Although software emulation of living personalities is illegal, reconstructions of famous historical figures are common. That's cool. The Reaper War. The Fall of Earth. The Reapers took Earth in a matter of hours. The Alliance knew the first wave would arrive from Batarian space, but they were unprepared for the speed and scale of the attack. The Reapers bypassed the 6th and 7th fleets at Terra Nova in Eden Prime, flying straight from relay to relay where they could neither be tracked nor intercepted. The tactic was unexpected, since the navies of organic species would never risk coming out of FTL within combat range or leaving enemies at their backs to threaten supply lines. Hold on, I got hair bothering me. Okay. At Arcturus Station, more than a dozen Reaper capital ships engaged the Alliance's 2nd, 3rd, and 5th fleets. This was mere screening for the main force. Dozens more capital ships continued through the Charon Relay, where the 1st fleet had been lying in wait but was soon destroyed. The 4th fleet, near Earth, had a few minutes of advance warning. It stood no better chance. After destroying Earth's comm buoys, smaller Reaper destroyers wiped out all GPS and communications satellites in Earth's orbit and cut the undersea fiber optic cables that linked the continents. Those bastards. Earth's resistance now relies on outdated radio towers and a few quantum entanglement communicators whose matched pairs happen to be on other continents or outside the Sol system. I said, you gotta be really thorough to go, like, under the sea to, like, cut these lines. Communication is so limited that the fate of entire nations remain unknown. The capital ships bombarded defense installations and industrial centers, annihilating entire cities with populations in the low millions, including Adelaide, Hamburg, Al-Jabal, and Fort Worth. Meanwhile, Reaper destroyers descended into the atmosphere to melt roads and capture population centers with minimal loss of life. This is not an example of the Reapers being merciful. More likely, they are hurting their prey to make the coming harvest that much easier. Great. The Fall of Karshan. For every 1,000 Batarian refugees, there are 1,001 stories about how the Reapers invaded the Batarian systems. A few elements are common to almost every version, however. The Reapers arrived first in the Volar system and immediately destroyed its communication network. The Hegemony's Department of Information Control blamed the loss of signal on space weather, but scrambled ships to the system nonetheless. Within a day, Reaper capital ships appeared in the Harsa system and descended on the Batarian homeworld, Karshan. For all the rhetoric about the Hegemony's military prowess, their response to the Reapers were uncoordinated. Moments after the information minister took to the extranet and announced that unknown ships were destroying all space traffic near Karshan, the defense minister declared there was no reason to panic. The planet's comm buoys were destroyed next, creating an ominous silence that has persisted ever since. Fearing they were next, Batarian colonies across Hegemony space began evacuations. So many refugees poured into the human-occupied Exodus cluster that Systems Alliance officials at first thought the Batarians were invading. More systems have gone dark as their comm buoys were destroyed, and millions more Batarians trapped on their planets sit waiting for the Reapers. Yeah. The Battle of Palavin. When Tetris fell, the Turians knew little about the Reapers except that they wanted to enrage the Turians. Staying calm, the Turians massed in force around Palavin, their homeworld. Fleet Admiral Irix Coronati, in what became known as the 15-minute plan, stationed only 2 carriers, undaunted and resolute, near the system's relay. When the Reaper fleet emerged, the carriers launched swarms of unmanned fighters and spy drones. These were quickly destroyed, but the drones transmitted vital data on the Reaper's effective range, fleet composition, and exact location. The Turians' other ships then deployed to defend the system in earnest. Knowing that the Reaper's weapons had a longer effective range than any of his own, Coronati made a short, daring FTL jump, landing his dreadnoughts in the middle of the Reaper fleet. The dreadnoughts then turned to line up their main guns on the Reapers, which also needed to turn fire on the Turians. This ploy used the Reaper's size against them. Because they could turn faster, the Turian dreadnoughts locked target first, and their concentrated firepower downed several Reaper capital ships. The Reapers countered instantly. Their destroyers performed a jump of their own to the skies above Palavin, beginning orbital strikes on Turian cities. The Turians, forced to defend the planet, found themselves in a pitched battle far from the relay, from which emerged a seemingly endless line of Reaper ships. After massive casualties, Coronati ordered retreat. The Turians insist that Palavin is not lost. The battle has merely moved to the ground. Reaper troop transports have dumped hordes of husks to capture Palavin's inhabitants, but met with little success. Reaper capital ships are destroying city after city, but much of the Turian fleet is still operable, and the citizenry is heavily armed. The Turians refuse to be intimidated. Good on you. Keep fighting. The Fall of Tetris. Actually, this... If I'd noticed, I would have read this first. The Reaper's first attack on Turian space followed an age-old maxim. Hit them where it hurts. A populous colony dating back centuries, Tetris was already embedded in the Turian psyche as the site of the worst terrorist attack in Turian history. Wounds were still raw from the Valum blast, in which a separatist revolutionary slammed a starship into the colony's capital, killing more than 100,000 Turians. Hierarchy forces respond with a massive invasion of the planet to stamp out the separatist movement. It was a catharsis for the Turians, reassuring them that heroes would always triumph over evil, and so the Reapers struck Tetris first. By the time Tetris went dark, the Turians had already learned that the Praetorians and humans were under attack. The Hierarchy was responded with what they believed was overwhelming force, only to walk into a trap. Reaper ships were waiting on the other side of the relay to Tetris, and they released devastating firepower the moment the fleet emerged. Turian leaders, observing the one-sided battle, were faced with a choice. Reinforce their side of the relay to defend against a Reaper invasion, or throw more resources into an offense. With soldiers and civilians alike clamoring for retribution against the Reapers, the Turians continued the assault. The Hierarchy sent warp bombs through the relay to clear a path, fighting tooth and talon to inflict casualties against the Reaper fleet. It was a valiant effort, but doomed. The Reapers emerged victorious from the relay and began broadcasting a single signal to Turian comm buoys. Images of Valum, Tetris' capital, once again a smoking wreck. The fight for Turian space had begun. So that's where it all started, and then it went to Palavin. Two more entries. I might just finish everything here. The Reapers, only one section. Reaper capabilities. The Reapers are technologically superior to the organic species of the galaxy, but the degree of that superiority is a matter of debate in the intelligence community. The Reapers' thrusters and FTL drives appear to propel them at more than twice the speed of Citadel ships. Estimates of their location in dark space suggest they can travel nearly 30 light-years in a 24-hour period. That's friggin' fast. Reaper power sources seem to violate known physical laws. Reapers usually destroy fuel infrastructure rather than attempting to capture it intact, indicating that Reapers do not require organic species energy supplies. Consequently, the Reapers attack without regard for maintaining supply lines behind them, except to move husks from one planet to another. Unlike Citadel ships, Reapers do not appear to discharge static buildup from their drive cores, although they sometimes appear wreathed in static discharge when they land on planets. The main gun on a Reaper capital ship dwarfs that of the Alliance's Everest-class dreadnoughts. No dreadnought has yet survived a direct hit from the weapon. Estimates put its destructive power anywhere from 132 to 454 kilotons of TNT. Even if the target is hardened, as in the case of a surface-based missile silo, the gun can instead bury the target beneath molten metal. Precise targeting computers and correctors also give Reaper weapons a longer effective range than organics, dreadnoughts, or cruisers. The kinetic barriers on a Reaper capital ship can shrug off the firepower of a small fleet. Weapons specifically designed to overcome shields, such as the Javelin, Guardian lasers, or the Thanix series, can bypass the barriers to some degree. The difficulty is getting close enough to use them. The surface-mounted weaponry on Reaper ships, similar in principle to Guardian, presents an effective defense against organic species fighters. And final category, weapons, armor, and equipment. Cool, we'll finish. Body armor. Modern combat hard suits have a triple canopy of protection. Shields, armor, and self-repair. The outermost layer is created through kinetic barrier emitters, which detect objects incoming at a high rate of speed and generate deflecting shields, provided they have enough energy in their power cells. If a bullet or other incoming object gets past the barrier, it contends with the more traditional body armor. A sealed suit of non-porous ballistic cloth provides kinetic and environmental protection. Reinforced by lightweight composite ceramic plates in areas that either don't need to flex or require additional coverage, such as the chest and head. When the armor is hit by directed energy weapons, the plates boil away to ablate rather than burning the wearer. The last level of protection is provided by the suit's microframe computers, whose input detectors are woven throughout the fabric. These manage the self-healing system, which finds rents in the fabric and, assuming any such tear would wound the flesh underneath, seals the area off with sterile, non-conductive metagel. This stanches minor wounds and plugs holes in the suit that could prove fatal in toxic environments. Soldiers are not always fond of the squish skin that oozes gel on them at a moment's notice, but fatalities have dropped sharply since the system was implemented. You've always wondered what that's like, metagel. Kinetic barriers, or shields. Kinetic barriers, commonly called shields, provide protection against most mass accelerator weapons. Whether on a starship or a soldier's suit of armor, the basic principle remains the same. Drink. Kinetic barriers are repulsive mass effect fields projected from tiny emitters. These shields safely deflect small objects traveling at rapid velocities. This affords protection from bullets and other dangerous projectiles, but still allow the user to sit down without knocking away their chair. The shielding afforded by kinetic barriers does not protect against extremes of temperature, toxins, or radiation. Mass accelerators. A mass accelerator propels a solid metal slug using precisely controlled electromagnetic attraction and repulsion. The slug is designed to squash or shatter on impact, increasing the energy it transfers to the target. If this were not the case, it would simply punch a hole right through, doing minimal damage. Accelerator design was revolutionized by Element Zero. I think I'm about done with reading, guys. A slug lightened by a mass effect field can be accelerated to greater speeds, permitting projectile velocities that were previously unattainable. If accelerated to a high enough velocity, a simple paint chip can impact with the same destructive force as a nuclear weapon. However, mass accelerators produced recoil equal to their impact energy. This is mitigated somewhat by the mass effect fields that rounds are suspended within, but weapon recoil is still the prime limiting factor on slug velocity. Small arms. Modern infantry weapons are micro-scaled mass accelerators using mass-reducing fields and magnetic force to propel miniature slugs to lethal speeds. Nearly every gun on the battlefield is laden with features, from targeting auto-assists to projectile shavers that can generate thousands of rounds of ammunition from a small internal block of metal. It was long thought that personal weapons had plateaued in performance, but the Geth proved all theories wrong. Mathematically reviewing their combat logs, the Geth found that in an age of kinetic barriers, most firefights were won by the side who could put the most rounds downrange the fastest. But combatants were forced to deliberately shoot slower to manage waste heat, or pause as their weapons vented. To eliminate this inefficiency, the Geth adopted detachable heat sinks known as thermal clips. While organic arms manufacturers were initially doubtful this would produce a net gain, a well-trained soldier can eject and swap thermal clips in under a second. Faced with superior enemy firepower, organic armies soon followed the Geth's lead, and today's battlefields are littered with these thermal clips. Tech armor and fortification. Although body armor and kinetic barriers provide significant protection for relatively low cost, technically savvy soldiers sometimes go further. Tech armor is the common term for a complex series of field generators that disrupt incoming force using a stationary warp effect. The theory is that bullets that would normally shatter on impact instead break apart when they strike the field. The field then bleeds away the shrapnel's kinetic energy. The standard design for tech armor traps the warp field between two low-yield kinetic barriers to protect the user from the field itself. When the outer barrier falls, the warp effect is discharged, potentially harming anyone nearby. For this reason, many soldiers modify the armor with a haptic-style light effect to warn allies not to get too close. On missions where stealth is paramount, this effect is disabled. Cynical soldiers joke that the design is called tech armor because if it were simply called warp armor, no one would use it. The fortification approach uses high-energy batteries and superconductive devices within the armor to create a Foucault current effect, essentially a magnetic field that can immobilize metals, even non-ferrous ones. The field is triggered by sensors similar to those in a kinetic barrier. It is powerful enough to protect against most modern weapons, but there are drawbacks. The currents cause metallic objects to hold their position relative to one another, and although the field only lasts for a split second, it creates resistance that can slow or fatigue the wearer. Without specialized training, a soldier can quickly become exhausted or stumble at the wrong time. And we're done. I can't believe I read all Codex. He's so far, anyway. Nice. So, thanks for watching, everyone. See you in the next episode when we actually do a mission or something like that. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.